Hi, my name's Joe Murphy. I am the co-host and co-founder of the Chef's Table Foundation. And I am here today with our other co-founder, Carol O'Connor, and co-host. And we have a special guest. We have the Massachusetts Secretary of Veterans Affairs. His name is Francisco Urena. And prior to becoming the state secretary, he was in the city of Boston. So thank you for coming, Secretary.
Thank you very much.
Great. You know, we dedicated ourselves, Carol and I, to raising money for homeless veterans. And we are filming tonight at the Kroc Center in Dorchester, a state-of-the-art building built by the Salvation Army. And they have a culinary school. So we are entering a very strong partnering relationship. And our hope is that as we find candidates that are considered homeless veterans, then they'll be coming here. So I've asked the secretary to maybe just talk about the situation with homeless veterans. And I recently saw something, actually it was a Rotary Club video on homelessness, and they were saying in the video, you wouldn't even know your next door neighbor or a person that you may know, that there are so many homeless people out there. So what's going on with the veterans as far as homelessness? I know there's the President Obama, and I've heard Governor Baker, Mayor Marty Walsh, they've all committed to wiping out homelessness with veterans. So what is the initiative right now in your department?
Absolutely, so thank you very much. It is an honor to be here at the Kroc Center joining the Chef's Table Foundation and bringing awareness to homelessness when it comes among veterans. And so in the Commonwealth, we have 365,000 veterans. Wow. That live and reside here with their families in some cases. We have a commitment in every city and town as a veteran service officer, an office dedicated to the aspect of providing services to both veterans and families of veterans. But as you mentioned, Joe, there is a need for homelessness among veterans to ensure that we provide a system of transition. Sometimes it's not for lack of resources, but connecting the resources to the folks in need, to the veterans in need in this case. And so on behalf of Governor Baker, Lieutenant Governor Perlito, on behalf on the state level, we have a commitment to ensure that we continue to drive down the numbers of homelessness. And we have done just that with partnering cities such as the city of Boston, which on the last 14 to 16 months have housed more than 500 homeless veterans, placed them in a transition plan, placed them in a home or location of their own. And so those types of focuses, strong, tangible commitments, such as what we see here in Boston and major and smaller cities throughout the Commonwealth, are the focus of how we are driving down the numbers.
And that's really encouraging. You know, as I learn more about just the term homeless, that doesn't necessarily mean they don't have a roof over their head, but they don't have their own permanent residence. So what is the situation with sheltered and homeless? Is there any statistic on that for the state?
At any given time, our last numbers, as of the last homeless census, it was about 1,100 homeless veterans. So people who have served in the military, some sort of connection. Mm-hmm. Here in the city of Boston, there has been a commitment of folks like Pine Street Inn, New England Center for Homeless Veterans, and others type of service providers, mm-hmm. who are partners in ensuring that we remove veterans from emergency shelter beds and keep them there as little as possible so that we could provide a sense of transition. It was very fortunate that the last numbers as counted during the last homeless census have been extremely lower than last. And that is because of the commitment of community partners, government officials, but also the average citizen who has been aware, is making those referrals, is driving down. And we're very fortunate as well. The economy is on our side, giving employment opportunities, giving funding to some of the providers who are on both subsidies from the government, but also from the donations from private citizens.
Wow, that's great. You know, I do know Senator Mike Rush. And I know the state of Massachusetts provides more benefits for veterans than any state in the country. Is that fair?
This is correct, absolutely.
Yeah, and I'm amazed that each town and city has its own veterans office.
Yes.
And I presume they're funded through the state or the local town or city?
Each individual veteran service officer is a municipal employee. We have a partnership with them. We have our financial assistance program that is there to assist veterans and families,
right,
or survivors, widows,
yeah,
who may be below the federal poverty rate. So our program is to assist veterans have a better quality of life, identify homeless veterans, and place them into a path of transition,
right,
and also provide a set of a safety net so that they could be able to, we reimburse them for their medical expenses, whether it's a co-payment,
yeah,
or whether, so that they could afford their prescription and also afford to put food on the table.
Yeah, and that's really fantastic when you think about how much this state cherishes their veterans. And, you know, what little knowledge I have, and Carol and I have really been gaining more and more as we move along, a lot of them have psychological issues, so there's really a rebuilding of the individual. And, you know, it's just a sad commentary, but I'm guessing a lot of these veterans have been in wars, they've been to hell and back, and it's not an easy transition. So, you know, Carol and I, when we got to the point, it'll be 3 years this June, when we became a 501c3 public nonprofit, we were reaching weekly 1.5 million people with the show. So that's when we determined it's a nonprofit, we had to become a nonprofit to film. And today, as we speak, we're reaching 3 million people 52 weeks a year with this show. And we were just invited into towns, two cities and two towns into New Hampshire, which is great because it just shows that the quality of the production. So this show has been a passion for Carol and I because we're both foodies, but we also want to help people. So we feel this is a great platform. And tonight we're in Dorchester at the Kroc Center, and it's the Kiwanis Club of Roxbury that is here with their members and friends to help support our work. So we're very grateful. And that helps us cover our costs are minimal, but you know, their petition helps, participation has helped us. And you know, just a quick note, Carol and I met the secretary 2.5 years ago when we ran an Oktoberfest, and I gotta tell you, he is such a great guy personally. In the event, Carol wanted to do it, because it was an Oktoberfest, a German cake eating contest, musical chairs contest, and the secretary was right there. And did you win, or did you step?
I think I got an honorable mention.
Oh, very
lost
good.
My lederhosen somewhere.
Yeah, there you go. And it just shows, he's just a great guy. And we're really thrilled that you're here, Secretary. So again, thank you.
Thank you.
And on tonight's show, we're going to do something I've been begging people for 3 years. We try to show diversity of cuisine. We've had Ethiopian, we've had Scottish food, which they told us there might be another Scottish restaurant in New Jersey, but Ethiopian, there's a couple in Boston. And the one thing for 3 years I could not find is soul food. Hmm. So, and I'll tell that story when Chef Celeste is up here, but it was funny how we met her, and we're thrilled that we're gonna do finally a show on Southern style soul food cooking. So thank you, Chef, there you go.
Wow.
I asked the secretary, what type of cooking do you like? He said, barbecue. I said, well, if you can come, we're gonna get you up there. So this is what we're trying to do tonight. And again, thank you.
Thank you very much. And thanks for your commitment once again to the community,
yeah,
to our local cuisines that we have throughout, but especially to our veterans. And to that,
right,
I thank you.
Okay, that's great. Well, we love doing what we do. So again, we'll be moving into the cooking segment, and you'll see Chef Joe, Mr. Wonderful, cooking along with Chef Celeste. And I didn't get a round of applause when I said Chef Wonderful, so I gotta perk this audience up a little bit. Okay, well, thank you. Hi, I'm Chef Joe Murphy, co-founder of the Chef's Table Foundation. The Chef's Table Foundation is dedicated to supporting homeless veterans or veterans in transition. And we're very pleased today to have a wonderful chef, and we're going to do soul food. Soul food is an ethnic food, and just the name soul, I want you to know this soul food is made by the sister who made them famous. So we have Chef, I'm sorry, she was not ready for that one. But in any event, we're really pleased. I've been, for 3 years, and I keep telling people, looking for somebody that would do a soul food show. But soul food also relates to Southern cooking, Chef. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So we have Chef Celeste, and we also have a special guest, and he's not a professional chef, but he is the Massachusetts Secretary for Veterans Affairs, and his name is Chef Francisco Urena.
Thank you.
Now, because ribs take a while to cook, and you know, using the dry rub method and smoking them, what we figured out, rather than have you watch for 6 hours, we're going to tell you and explain technique. And the good thing is, if you remember to go to chefstableseries.tv, you can take your iPad, your laptop, or your computer and rewatch the show and listen to the technique along with Chef Celeste. Now, one advantage we have today, there's a great spice that Chef created, and it's Lyndigo Spice. So we're very pleased that we're going to be tasting her ingredients here today. So, as we move along, Chef, one thing I always talk about, because we try to make this show as educational as possible, we talk about the term mise en place. Mise en place is a French technique, or French word. It means everything in its place. So that when you start cooking, you're not running around at the last minute, or the meal doesn't taste quite right when it's all done. Maybe you left out an important ingredient. So if you have everything lined up with mise en place, okay, the chances are you're going to have a much more enjoyable cooking experience, but you're going to have consistency, okay, in whatever dishes you like to make. So Chef, tell us, I know you're doing stovetop cornbread, correct, which is right here.
Then skillet cornbread.
Okay, and what else do we have here?
So we have macaroni and cheese.
Okay.
Collard greens with pork fat.
Pork fat.
And then we have some ribs seasoned with my spice rub.
Excellent. Mm-hmm. And one thing that the chef has done, and you know, I say this on many shows, so I'm going to share it. Soul food has a lot of cholesterol or fats, generally. Chef has taken a lot of that excess out of it. And you use, for instance, for your milk, you're using a 2% milk, and you're cutting a lot of the fats out of these recipes. So we're pleased to present that to you.
Now, collard greens. Mm-hmm. I did not grow up with collard greens. Mm-hmm. So why don't you talk about that?
So a Southern people's cabbage. They're collard greens. They're loaded with lots of nutrients. They're very good for you.
Yeah.
But typically, when people think of soul food and collard greens, you think they're sitting on the stove all day,
right,
cooking in fat. The way I cook them, I braise them.
Oh.
And I season them with the salt pork after.
Wow.
So I typically start off stripping them. Yeah, anybody saw the soul here knows how to strip a green, so I'm gonna show you.
All right,
here's your knife. All right, so you just take the stem off.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Just break it off. That's easy, yes,
I'm
yes.
I'm glad you didn't say the good-looking chef because I need a tummy.
No.
I need not, a tummy tuck
not
before
that
I
kind
do
of
that.
Stripping, yep, and you just roll it up.
Okay, you need to combine them both,
yeah, right? Yeah, as many leaves as you want,
okay,
as possible.
There we are.
Mm-hmm. And then you take your knife,
yeah,
and you go down the middle.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. And then you just start to cut them.
You tuck those fingers in.
Yep, tuck your fingers in. Be safe. So you get the gist of it. So from that state, I freeze them ahead of time, and then that doesn't take as long to cook.
Oh.
If you freeze them like a day ahead of time,
yeah.
And then you take them out of the freezer, and you boil that, you put them in a pot with a little water and let them unthaw, okay, in the water.
Right.
Pour that water off and then you start building your braise,
okay?
And so with these, the ones that you have today that everybody's gonna be eating, I use chicken broth, organic chicken broth. I try and use organic, all natural. I use no preservatives in any of my cooking.
Right.
I try and use olive oil. In place of butter, I do use butter when I need to, okay? But most of the time I use olive oil.
Which is great.
Right. So I braise this in organic chicken broth,
nice,
for about an hour. They start to get soft.
Sure.
And because we froze them, you know, it's not going to take as long, maybe a couple hours. Then I add onion and my Lyndigo Spice Rub. Cider vinegar, a pinch of sugar, because you need that, because
right,
greens can be a little bitter. You
right,
get that, a pinch of sugar, and you just let that sit,
yeah,
and you can let them braise. You let them braise down.
Okay. Interject one thing? Braising is a technique that it's generally you cook it at a low, very low boil, and that's designed to soften, for instance, let's say you're going to cook a brisket, okay, very stringy, very tough. So the process to tenderize is braising. So don't let it boil, if it's a meat, don't let it boil like crazy because that muscle just gets so tight. You just want a gentle roll.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know if you want to boil or a gentle...
Just a gentle roll. You don't want them boiling.
Okay.
And then I like a little crunch in mine,
yeah,
just a little. Some people like to cook them, you know, till they're really tender and soft.
Yeah.
You know, it's your preference.
Okay.
But the longer they sit,
yeah,
you know.
And Chef just gave you a great tip. And I always say it, that relates to exactly what she just said. You're cooking to taste. What you're learning here are techniques, chef's interpretation, which is probably a great interpretation, but it's her interpretation. If you like them softer, braise them longer. It's up to you. You know what your friends, your family likes. And by the way, do you think your husband Joe would mind if I take you home?
He would.
Oh, okay.
He would. Yes, yes.
Yeah, I mean, you could be cooking this stuff for me all the time.
No.
Okay.
He would.
Yeah, all right. Well, can we all come over Sunday?
Good try.
Okay, great.
So then in the last, and once they're done,
yeah.
So what I've done, I've taken the salt pork,
okay,
and I've cut it into just small dice.
Yeah.
And you cook them till they're brown.
So you're sauteing.
Yeah, this was done ahead of time. Yes, right. So this was done ahead of time. So this is sitting. This is not cooking with your grains.
Oh, okay.
So you don't have to add this. Yeah. So this is just to flavor it. You're not cooking in the fat.
Okay.
If you want, I do put a little olive oil in the braids. So when your greens are done, you take the rendered lardons and the fat that it was rendered in, and you pour that over the greens, and that's what's going to season it.
Okay.
And I use very little salt in my cooking. People know when I cook for them, I don't mind if you grab the salt shaker or a little bit more spice rub. Right. It's fine. I'm not going to be offended because it's to your taste. Right. But I don't cook with a lot of salt because you don't need it.
Right. You know? Right. Yeah. And you're using the salt pork?
The salt pork. So you won't need it. Yeah.
Right.
If you put it in, I cook in layers.
Yeah.
So it's called layer cooking. And, well, what I made of it probably is a term for it.
No, it is.
Know.
It's layer.
Okay.
And that really makes your dish.
And it does.
Yeah. When you start learning how to layer your flavors, and it's really like building a wall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the same strategy. Mm-hmm. Just keep building those layers. And guess what? If you make a mistake and it's not the greatest and you're not happy with it, make your husband eat it, okay? Save the good piece for yourself. But, you know, this brings up another great tip. You have salt pork, all right? And it's fried off.
Yep.
It's browned, but it's still going to have residual salt. So if you have a sodium intake issue for health reasons, leave the salt out.
Right.
Because you're going to have some put into, and I'm guessing in the rubs, and there's probably some sodium in there.
My spice rub is a low sodium spice rub.
Okay.
And I had to make this for my loving husband, Joe.
Oh, hey, whatever.
Joe loves barbecue, but Joe has a hypertension problem. So I said, the only way you're going to have barbecue, and I'm going to make it for you, is if I use this rub. And it just took off from there. So that's what I seasoned the ribs with.
Okay. Now, on the ribs, well, let's talk about your pasta, your macaroni and cheese, because that's a staple in Southern cooking.
It is. It sure is. And a lot of people, you know, everybody's mama and grandmama has their own macaroni and cheese, and their aunties is the best or whatever. Okay, fine.
Right.
If that's what you feel, that's what you feel.
Yeah.
But I think if you use, you don't need 8 different cheeses. If you use fine ingredients, you don't need all of that, because it's a lot of cholesterol, okay? I use regular pasta in mine. I boil it. I don't put oil or salt in the water. I cook it to al dente. The cheese that I use a extra sharp. You get the extra, extra sharp yellow cheddar cheese. I use an extra, extra sharp white cheddar cheese, and I use a Gruyere. So I use 3, and that's all I need.
Right.
And the key I find is if you use a lesser percent of milk, like the 2%, or even a 1%, if you're trying to not keep have so much fat in it, I use a 2% milk. So I boil the pasta to al dente. I season the pasta a little bit with a little sea salt. I like the Himalayan pink salt, it's to your preference, but I season the noodles, and I also season it with black pepper.
Okay.
Then you put it in your pan, mix the yellow cheese with the pasta.
Okay.
And
before you add, you don't incorporate the cheese into your milk?
That's next.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, so I add the yellow cheese to the pasta. That's to give it the color, because the white is not good once you mix it with the other thing.
Right.
So then I start off make my basic bechamel. If you don't want to use butter, you can make a roux with the olive oil, extra light olive oil. Butter, flour, make your roux, start adding your milk to build your bechamel.
Right.
Then I add the Gruyere and the extra white, extra sharp white cheddar cheese. And then you mix it. Yeah, you incorporate that till it's hot. Exactly.
Okay.
And put it all together and put it over the pasta.
Right.
And then the secret that I put on mine is I used an all-natural cheese cracker and some panko crumbs.
Nice.
And a little bit of smoked paprika. Just, and I also put the smoked paprika in the bechamel sauce as well, because it just gives it another layer.
Another layer.
And you season your bechamel with some salt, a little salt, but remember not too much because cheese has salt in it as well.
Of course.
And
so again, Chef just gave you another tip. When you're cooking, think through to the end of the recipe, mm-hmm. how much salt do you need? Mm-hmm. If it needs salt when you're finished, and give it a taste, you can always add.
Mm-hmm.
But you have three cheeses that have salt, and it probably is plenty.
Yeah, it's enough. And then I coat this with, I put on the top, it's panko crumbs and a cheese cracker in a food processor, and put that. Nice. And you bake it off at 350 for until it starts to bubble.
And then it's done.
And then it's done.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I like the idea of the panko, because a panko is, I don't know, maybe the last 8-10 years, a lot of chefs are using it even for breading. It's a much larger piece of, it's not like a fine breadcrumb. It's thicker, it clings better, and you get that extra crunch mm-hmm. that you may not mm-hmm. with mm-hmm. the fine.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to just go back, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Talk about your bechamel
mm-hmm.
and a roux, okay? If you don't know what a roux is, it's butter or olive oil. And then what you do is you heat it up, and then you mix your flour
mm-hmm.
into it, okay? And when you add the milk, that's your thickening agent. I've started using not just flour, but I'll also use, and I'm drawing a blank here, sorry. The Chinese use it when they make their slurry.
Cornstarch.
See, Chef knows.
All right.
Very good. So anyway, I like cornstarch because it's very fine. It incorporates well
mm-hmm.
with the butter or the oil. And then when you add that or add your hot liquid into the hot, it really incorporates and thickens very
mm-hmm.
well.
Mm-hmm.
And if you over thicken, add a little bit more milk or liquid. You can always loosen it up because this is going to be baking.
Mm-hmm.
So in that baking process, it's going to start drying out mm-hmm. as well. So again, that's to taste. If you like a dry mac and cheese, mm-hmm. or if you like a little bit moister, use your own judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, can we talk about those ribs?
Oh yes, the ribs.
Okay. So why don't we, what I'd like you to do is explain, you know, you have the St. Louis, you have the baby backs, you have the spare ribs.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we were talking, Chef and I, earlier about the spare ribs.
Yeah, I typically like to use the baby back because I find them to be a little bit meatier and they're much more leaner.
Yeah.
Or the St. Louis style. The St. Louis style is just a spare rib with that big piece of fat cut off. And yeah.
Right.
And, so I either use that or the baby back. Today we used baby back ribs. So what I did was my spice rub, well let me go back. When you get a rack of ribs, you turn it over. There may be a film. Some butchers will take it off.
Right.
On the back of the rib there's a fine film. You need to take that off. Just peel that off. It comes off pretty easily. Get a paper towel and just rinse, take it off. Pull it off. That way your marinade or whatever you're going to season it with gets on the back of the rib as well as the front.
Yeah.
So what I did with these, with my spice rub, I mixed it with a little olive oil
mm-hmm.
and a little apple juice. And I made like a paste.
Oh.
And I rubbed it all over the ribs and I let them sit for a couple of hours.
Nice.
And then I smoke them on the smoker with some apple wood. You can use whatever wood you like. I like apple wood because it's just a sweeter smoke.
Right.
It's not as harsh as hickory.
Right.
Some people like it. So whatever you want to smoke it with. Indirect heat, and you just want to smoke it. So I smoked them at like 225 for maybe an hour and a half.
Okay.
And then I always finish my barbecue in the oven just to make sure that it's cooked well through.
Right.
You want a temperature of 165 degrees, you know, to make sure it's done. So I put it in the oven.
Excuse me, that's an internal temperature.
The internal temperature.
Right. Yeah, and just make sure you have a good, I hate these big ones you get in the supermarket. If you can find one, there are a lot of specialty stores that would sell the smaller, and it's, they're more of a professional, but they just give a true reading.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And on the smoking process, let's say we can't afford our own smoker.
Uh-huh.
Could you use your grill and then set it up so?
Oh, yeah.
How would you do that?
You can use a grill. Just put one layer of charcoal down, get some wood chips, soak them.
Mm-hmm.
When the briquettes start to turn white,
yeah.
You put the wet wood on top and then you're going to get that smoke.
Okay.
That's where the smoke is going to come from.
Good.
And then you just put the lid on and you just smoke it.
Right. Okay, if I could ask Chef Secretary a question. How's she doing?
I think she's doing fine.
Okay, great.
Making my mouth water, I'm sure the audience is.
Exactly. So, you know, in cooking ribs, okay, which I don't do a lot of, but I'm going to now, that I'm learning some techniques, it's the length of that smoking is going to help tenderize.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, I was cooking for somebody a few years ago, and they said, I want to tenderize this. Do you have a good marinade? Well, a marinade is not a tenderizer.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a flavoring process. But Chef mentioned a couple of times about apple cider vinegar. That's a pH, okay? So that, in a sense, is like a ceviche.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they do it in lemon juice. That's the pH.
Mm-hmm.
And that cooks and tenderizes. And you make an apple juice,
yeah,
blend.
Mm-hmm.
And what's in there?
I just mix it with the apple juice, olive oil, and the spice rub.
And
mm-hmm.
the spice rub.
Yeah.
So
mm-hmm.
again, you know, it's a sweetened apple juice, I'm guessing.
Right.
But it still has some pH,
mm-hmm.
okay, or an acid.
And
so
it's important to let your meat come to room temperature. Don't put cold meat on a hot grill,
because
you will not, it will not cook properly.
Okay.
So that's, and I learned the hard way.
Okay.
So I know.
Well, you know what, even professional chefs, and I'm not gonna mention a particular chef that has been on the show,
mm-hmm.
he's the executive chef for not a huge chain of restaurants, but very high-end restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
They have 7 restaurants, and they do about $50, $60 million a year in sales.
Mm-hmm.
And he was telling me how he came up with this item.
Mm-hmm.
He said, we just kept testing
mm-hmm.
it, trying it. Until we got the method we wanted.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're home, again, this goes back to taste. Keep doing it, don't give up. You know, it's really an art form,
mm-hmm.
cooking. You don't have to be a rocket scientist. You just have to have the passion, the patience, and when you get it perfected, the three of us will be absolutely thrilled, okay? So, okay, now, I don't think we talked about the cornbread.
The cornbread, yeah, so this pan here is actually my mother-in-law's skillet. She passed before I never met her,
yeah.
But my husband kept all of her stuff. His sister's not too happy about it, but
oh, yeah.
You know, I have them, so every time I make cornbread, I send her a picture. But yeah, this is a skillet cornbread, and you'll see all of that on there. It's never touched water.
Right.
It's seasoned very well. And I, like I said, I never got a chance to meet Vivian, but every time I use her skillet, I.
Well, you live about a quarter of a mile from my house. So tell Joe if I happen
to
call
you. No, you can tell Joe yourself.
Oh, yeah.
Let me know how that turns out.
Joe's about the same height as the secretary. and he's a little bit bigger, so I'm gonna behave.
But yeah, so I'm a cook, I am not a baker, so you know, you can use whatever cornbread recipe your auntie, grandmother, or mama gave you, okay? But if you get one of these skillets, you will never want to have cornbread in a regular pan again, okay? So what I did, I just used a regular all-natural organic cornbread mix that I had. It's, you know, I added oil, milk, and egg.
Eggs.
And the key is...
Sugar?
There's sugar already in the mix. So with this, you start it on top of the stove. So I melted butter in the pan, and you melt that all over, and you let it get all over it. And not till just a little smoke, that's it, okay? And then you pour the batter into that, and it'll start to cook, sizzle, and then you just put it in the oven, and you cook it to the direction. So it was like 400, I think, for like 20 minutes or so.
Right, yeah.
The wonderful students here.
Yeah, I love cornbread, and the best cornbread that I ever had was at the Union Oyster House.
Mm-hmm.
And they give out their recipe.
Mm-hmm.
So I do a scratch cornbread,
mm-hmm.
and I'll do a half sheet
mm-hmm.
at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And I gotta tell you, everybody, would you make that? Would you
mm-hmm.
do? And I just love cornbread. Most people
mm-hmm.
love cornbread. This
mm-hmm.
is a new technique.
Mm-hmm.
I owned a good sized bakery,
mm-hmm.
and a Boston based bakery in Roslindale, actually. And so we used to do. I'm not a baker either. I just, all I like to make was real old world crusty bread.
Mm-hmm.
So I bought the bakery,
mm-hmm.
and it was a nightmare. 24/7, but in any event, it was part of my story and my sea bag, I guess. But anyways, I love cornbread,
mm-hmm.
and this is, that's a great way to start,
mm-hmm.
actually,
yeah.
on the stovetop,
mm-hmm.
and then it gets right in the
oven. You get that nice crust on the end. You
yeah.
see how it turned.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, it that's really great.
Mm-hmm.
And really, if you have, I use a wooden chopstick. I keep them in one
mm-hmm.
of my chef's bags, and when I'm doing it, and just stick it in, and if it's coming out dry, then you know it's cooked, okay? So, I want to thank you, Chef.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, and you've done a great job,
mm-hmm.
and Chef, you've done a
oh,
great
thank
job.
You did an awesome
thank
job.
You.
So remember, if you want to watch this show again, please go to chefstableseries.tv. And on behalf of the Rockford Kiwanis Club, the Kroc Center in Dorchester, we want to thank you very much for being here, and especially our special guest.
Thank you.
Secretary Francisco Urena. He's the Secretary of Veterans Affairs for the state of Massachusetts. So please, try this, okay? And it smells, I can tell you, the ribs, I'm ready to dive on. I don't think I can take the secretary. He's a lot better shape and younger, but I might be quick and sneak a rib before he sees it gone. So again, thank you for watching this show. And remember our veterans that need our support. They were there for us, and we need to be there for them. So thank you very much.
Hello everyone, and welcome to this week's Craft Beer Pairing. My name is Carol O'Connor, co-host of the Chef's Table Series. I am here with Kelsey Roth. He is the brand manager of Craft Beer Cellar, as well as a certified cicerone, an excellent beer expert. So today, we are featuring a special beer to go with Celeste Croxton-Tate. She owns Lyndigo Spice, as well as her own catering company. So she makes all these special spices to rub on meats, chicken, as well as ribs. So today we're talking about ribs.
And barbecue ribs.
Barbecue ribs and
so
special rub.
Of course, I go to Belgium.
Who thinks of Belgium?
No, who thinks of Belgium when you think of barbecue ribs? Classic Southern style, the collard greens, the cornbread, the mac and cheese. Salt pork. And so all that intensity is going to need a beer that stands up to it. And
that's right.
So I went with, this is Brasserie D’Achouffe out of Belgium. And a chouffe is a gnome in in Belgium. So we got the little gnome on the label. And they this is a Belgian strong dark ale is what it's categorized as. And it's about 8% alcohol. So it's got a little bit more heft to it. Mm-hmm. It's got a lot of good kind of sweetness, but also some dark fruit notes. Let's open it up here so you can try it for yourself. And
Look at even the cap.
Yeah, even the cap has a little gnome on it.
Even the cap has a gnome on it. These graphic designers are just excellent.
And this is this is kind of bottle we also don't see in the U.S. very often. It's kind of a little squat bottle, and that's because this beer is re-fermented in the bottle. And what that means is they do a secondary round of fermentation. They put some extra yeast in here and a little bit of sugar, and what that does is it creates more carbonation. It eats the oxygen out of there, so it helps preserve the beer a little bit more. But also creates this nice head.
Right.
But these bottles can withstand a lot of pressure because the pressure builds up in there.
So cute.
Yeah, so let's try it.
I gotta twirl.
Yeah, so we do some twirling. Mm-hmm. And the darkness of this beer is gonna kind of match, the roastiness is gonna match the barbecue, but the sweetness is really gonna balance out that salt pork, the mac and cheese, which can have a little bit of salt to it, those collard greens.
Ooh, that's tasty.
Mm-hmm. But with a dry finish too. It doesn't linger. The sweetness doesn't hang on. Mm-hmm. It's finish is clean. Allows you to go back in and get some more ribs and another sip of beer.
Yeah, I was gonna say this definitely would go well with the beer. I love it. With the food.
Yeah.
It's good. Kelsey, excellent.
Thank you.
And this is one of your favorite graphics.
Oh, I love these guys. Yeah, it's like a little Scottish thing, and he's and he has like a little plaid on. And
so cute. Love it. And this is an excellent craft beer pairing.
Yes, thank
Great
you.
Great job. So everyone, I'm Carol O'Connor of the Chef's Table series, and this has been the craft beer pairing for Celeste Smoked Ribs.
I'm Kelsey Roth with Craft Beer Cellar, and we're a proud supporter of the Chef's Table Foundation.
To the coffee segment on the Chef's Table series. My name is Carol O'Connor, co-host, and I am here at Recreo in West Roxbury, and we're going to talk about roasting. So I'm here with owners Hector and Miriam Morales, husband and wife team here, and they're going to tell us about this big machine, how to make coffee roasted. So Hector, tell me about this machine. It's amazing.
Yes, this is my new toy here in West Roxbury.
That's a good word, toy.
And this is very important in how you roast coffee, just to get the proper flavor at the end result. Mm-hmm. So it's an IR12 machine, and the first stage is the green beans.
They set out green?
Oh yes, they come from our farm in Hinotega, Nicaragua, in these burlap bags, protected by green straw bags inside. Mm-hmm. And that's about 150 pounds, 69 kilos of green beans. And there it looks like this. So I usually, the machine goes for 25 pounds a batch. I usually do a little less than that. And I pour the green beans on top. Mm-hmm. Then I let it go here, and it goes to the drum. Yeah. This is kind of like the oven, the drum, and it's infrared light.
So it's cooking it.
It's cooking it right here, yes, for about, let's say, it's usually less than 20 minutes, depending on the roast that you want. And then I have to control everything, also all the temperature and the air pressure, and the different intervals, the gas, and all that
for
the different.
To go into roasting.
It is.
The yummy delicious coffee we love
it
to
is.
Have.
Now, every time I roast, I have to focus on the roasting here. And then at the proper time, when it reaches a certain temperature, the one that you want,
yes.
you let it go. And then it goes to the cooling beam down here for about 2 or 3 minutes cooling off. It comes out at a very high temperature. It's about 400 degrees. And meanwhile, you can always check it out here.
Mm-hmm.
You can take out some of the beans and check out the color and how it's going.
It must smell so nice in here when it roasted.
It does, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And it hits the place a little bit, although when it's roasted, you can touch the machine. It's not like burning hot, mm-hmm. but it gets hot. But the smell, it's delicious.
I think that's so amazing. It goes from green, cooks, and then it comes down into these beautiful roasted
beans. Yes. Oh, yes. And then from here,
mm-hmm.
it goes to the grinder and
yep.
then brewing. And yep. then you get your cup of coffee.
That's right. All the different blends that people can have.
Right.
Perfect.
Right.
Excellent. Very educational. I think a lot of people, even Joe was saying, people just, they go to the store, they buy it, or they don't realize the process.
Yes.
And especially and this is your family's,
yeah.
the beans, right here.
Yeah, and I think to add something that makes us special, it's small batch. So you can really make sure that product is unique.
Mm-hmm.
It's not made in a manufacturing facility, but he's making sure that the right color, that the roast matches exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So there's consistency in
right.
roast. You're not gonna come and one day it's bitter, one day it's not bitter.
Mm-hmm.
It's always, I think, special because it's made just for under 20 pounds.
Oh, that's amazing. That's a beautiful machine.
It is. It is. And it's customized, actually, for our store. Mm-hmm. It's that's why it's red. You can you can ask for different colors.
Yeah,
and
I love it. It's very industrial looking. It goes well with the brick in here and the
right.
excellent way you decorate it.
Mm.
I love it. It's so warm, comforting. So everyone, this has been the coffee segment on the Chef's Table series. I'm here with owners Hector and Miriam Morales of Recreo Coffee and Roastery in West Roxbury. See you next time.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to this week's Farm to Table Tip. I'm Carol O'Connor, co-host of the Chef's Table series. I am here with the farmer's farmer, Steve Verrill, and we're going to talk about leeks. So I guess all this is leeks, correct?
This is the beginning. They're one of the longest season crops we grow, and we have to start them really early.
How long does
Here
it take?
Here it is early March, and we won't pick these till late summer.
No way!
Yeah.
It's that long?
Late summer. And
all right, let me pick up one. There you go.
Oh! You didn't grab one, you grabbed 200.
I was wondering why they were so heavy. Oh my goodness. 200,
yeah,
wow.
Yeah, that actually leeks are something that don't take up a lot of space when they grow. When they grow up, they just grow 4 or 5 inches and
yep.
like several blades of grass. So they don't have to be spaced out as
mm-hmm.
much as some of the other plants. And we can kind of crowd them in so they don't take up too much screen.
That was good.
Yeah. Cause we do use a lot of greenhouse space for all the different plants,
yes.
and we try to put them in the appropriate size
mm-hmm.
containers.
Mm-hmm.
And these will be planted individually in the field. Each square
yep.
is one plant, and that's the way we put them down the row.
Yeah, that's a good catch, Steve.
Yeah.
Now, for the home planter, what are your suggestions they do if they don't have a greenhouse?
Well, you could start them in a window.
In a window.
In
yep.
a window, a south window, of course.
Yes.
And I don't know the best way. You have to pull them apart, so you could plant them an inch or two apart, and
yes.
then just separate them when it's time to put them in the ground. And that probably would be late April.
Yes.
Be a time to put them out fairly safely for leeks.
Mm-hmm.
And now you notice today it's showering.
Yes.
And he just came in to check to see about watering the greenhouse. And where the sun's not out, we're not going to water today. If it's cool and damp, you get too much problem with disease and so on. So we don't water until the sun comes out generally.
Oh, that's interesting. So to go back to the word you just said, disease, these can get diseased? Is that what you said?
In the crops. In
really?
With the cold, wet is... Either cold, wet, or warm, wet, they both produce different diseases.
Oh,
generally, wet is the word, as long as things aren't too wet.
Yeah.
The pressure isn't that great.
Oh, interesting.
But yeah, these, we'll put these out in the field. They'll get planted about 6 inches apart, and they'll grow up big. And
we, almost as tall as me?
Oh, not quite, but halfway.
Halfway.
Yeah.
Excellent.
And like I say, we probably won't pick any until late August, but then we can pick them right up probably till after Thanksgiving.
I'm coming on 8 in August.
Okay.
And I have some. Excellent. So everyone, this has been the Farm to Table Tip on Leeks. And I'm Carol O'Connor, co-host of the Chef's Table series.
And Steve Verrill, proud sponsor of Chef's Table Foundation.
Hi folks, Steve LeCount, chef owner of Chiara Bistro in Westwood, coming at you this week with this week's Chef's Tip of the Week. This week I wanted to talk about a piece of equipment that I find totally invaluable at the restaurant. For relatively short money, you can buy one of these. They come in smaller sizes as well for the home use, but it's called a food mill. And the reason we love it so much is we have a signature dish that's a potato gnocchi on there. And these food mills come with usually with a set of three different dies. This is the largest one. And then there's a little spring-loaded blade here. So when you put that die in, you want that curved side facing up, and then you just place the blade into the hole in the center, and this is why the spring is there. You push down on this and hook it onto these little hooks, and from there, it's as easy as one, two, three. What I love about this is, again, we make our potato gnocchi with them. This is what we pass our potatoes through. But there are many, many uses for this. You can do it for butternut squash, cooked pumpkin, anything that carrots, whatever you like to have make a puree out of. You could put a finer die in there with smaller holes if you want that puree to be totally smooth. But today I'm going to show you mashed potatoes because people often ask, how do you get those potatoes so smooth? Mine always have lumps in them. And I've got some cooked right behind me. Okay, so that's what it comes out looking like. Not a lump in this. So I'm going to season those a little bit, salt and pepper. My butter is already in the cream. I'm just going to add a little as I need it. And then just all I have to do from there is stir. Now, today we all have food processors. It's one of the worst things you can ever try to make mashed potatoes with, and I'll tell you why. Potatoes have natural gluten in them. It's just like flour. If you overwork it, that gluten, it ends up being, the gluten is just what forms like elasticity in bread doughs, and potatoes have quite a bit of natural gluten in there. So the more you move the potatoes around, the more that gluten you're activating, and you're going to end up with a gummy, stretchy kind of potato. So if you ever try to do it in a food processor for mashed potatoes, I guarantee you they're going to come out like glue. Where these are nice and fluffy, they haven't got a lump in them, smooth as silk. And I'm going to go eat these right now. So, Steve LeCount from Chiara Bistro in Westwood with this week's Chef's Tip of the Week. Thanks.
And we can kind of crowd them in so they don't take up too much screen space.
That should be in the thing. That was good.
Yeah.
The salt pork, so you won't need it. Yeah, you put, and if you put it in, I cook in layers.
Tuck those fingers in.
Yep, tuck your fingers in.